Now, lately came an interesting Patreon question up from my oberst Nick, and he asked,
what is the best French tank in 1940?
Because he saw my comparison between the Panzer III and the T-34, and he asked, well, what would be the best tank for 1940 for the French? And again, I do a comparison to a Panzer in this case, and we are focusing on the technical, tactical level. So we assume basically they come out of factory with most stuff as planned and see on the lower level how they work. So no operational or strategic aspects. So if you want to know the difference between this, watch this video, which is way under viewed because it's very important to understand these aspects. Now, the factors are basically the same: firepower, ergonomics, invisibility, armor protection, mobility, and communications. So, okay, which French tanks would be the best for the comparison here? And basically, we could say it's the S-35 Somua and the Char B1. Now, I go for the S-35 Somua here because there's several reasons for this. First off, the Char B1 was basically very archaic at this design. He was also very huge, which just makes him a huge target, bad to camouflage and everything else. He was also way slower, and as Zaloga points out, its reliability was less. Of course, one could argue that Char B1 had better armor, but the Somua was also mostly, couldn't be touched very much by the German General 37mm anti-tank gun. So the better armor made not much difference, and overall it had, other problems that the S-35 didn't have. Now, to which German Panzer we compare it? Now we have the Panzer III and the Panzer IV D. I here go with the Panzer IV because at this point the Panzer IV had a 75mm gun, although a short one, but the Panzer III still had a 37mm gun. So the firepower in both the and armor piercing and especially in the high explosive situation was way better with the Panzer IV. Now it should also be noted that for Zaloga, the tanker's choice for 1940 was the S-35 Somua, so he also, the Char B1, is not really that. So now let's look at the firepower. Now, the German Panzer IV D had the 75mm L-24, so the caliber length, it's a rather short weapon, which means a rather limited amount of muzzle velocity, which badly affects, of course, the ammo piercing capability. So it could penetrate about 31mm at 100 meters distance at a 30 degree angle. At 500 meters, it sank to 38mm. So there also were heat ammunition, actually four different types of heat ammunition. But in the reports and everything I read, they were barely mentioned, and I assume they were very well undersupplied. So again, we assume a standard weapon loadout, and they probably had only a few heat rounds. So they had a stronger armor piercing capability, but not very well supplied. Interestingly enough, Karl-Heinz Frieser, the author of Blitzkrieg Legend, pointed out that this gun had a very bad accuracy. He mentioned one example where the Panzer troops booted out of the tanks and attacked French anti-tank guns in close combat. Now, I looked into this, but I couldn't find anyone else who noted that there was a bad accuracy for this weapon. Additionally, later on in the war, was built into the Panzer III, the later versions, I think around the N Ausführung. And also, it was also used in the early Sturmgeschütze, which were, as referred by Wettstein, were generally very more accurate than the Panzerwaffe because, they were artillery units, so they were better trained. So if this weapon was really that inaccurate, I couldn't find anything there, and everything else seems to contradict it. So I assume that the reason they booted out there was for a different kind, maybe they didn't see it or something. But from what I know, and I could find, the weapon has no accuracy problem. Now, very interestingly, the French 47mm gun for the tanks is both described by Zaloga and Frieser as excellent. Whereas Chifton, in his video on the S-35, notes out, it's not a fantastic gun. It's a good anti-armor piercing gun, And if you look at the penetration values, they're actually less than for the 75mm gun. They're at 39mm at 100 meters and 33 at 500 meters, both at a 30 degree angle. Now for the rate of fire, I could sadly not find any information, but the shell of the 75mm gun was 6.8 kilogram, whereas for the 47mm it was 1.62. So as you can imagine, it probably was a bit easier and faster to load the 47mm gun. Of course, there's one major issue. The Panzer IV had a 3-man turret, whereas the Somua had a 1 or 1.5-man turret. So why 1.5-man turret? Because basically the radio guy could stand up and help the commander, who was also the gunner, with reloading. So how much that actually helped in real life, I don't know, but I assume that the rate of fire of the Somua was basically better. And since the armor piercing values are pretty much the same, I would say we have a draw or even a slightly better aspect for the Somua in the armor piercing department, but for the HE round, for the high explosive round, the 75mm is clearly better. So I would say a minor victory here for the Panzer IV-D. Now, since we spoke about the 3-man and the 1.5-man turret, it's time to move through ergonomics and visibility. Well, the Panzer IV had a 3-man turret, which is basically the standard, and the S-35 had the so-called 1-man orchestra. So the commander was both the gunner and sometimes also the loader. And as reported by German troops sometimes, once combat started, the French tanks barely moved because the commander was usually occupied with firing and not commanding. So also he couldn't act as a spotter mostly, so he was had to focus on one task. So in other ways, the French tanks were very well armored, but they also basically turned into pillboxes. So you could move them to a certain degree, but once combat started, they usually were outflanked and swarmed. Additionally, there are German reports who noted that the past French tanks were camouflaged, and it seems that the French tanks didn't see them. This is also supplied by the chieftain who is in the S-35, and he notes that the visibility is horrendous. Additionally, they used mostly vision slits, so there was no cover for splatter. So just slits, no glass block or something. This means if a bullet or something hits there, it gets in your face. Also for the commander, on the top of the turret there was a dome cupola for looking out. But the Germans, when they captured it, they replaced it with their commander's cupola, which they usually do with every captured tank from what I know, which provided way more better visibility. And speaking of that, the Panzer IV, of course, had the commander's cupola already there. Now, for the Panzer IV vision devices, there was a twin periscope for the driver and they had vision ports. So I couldn't find any clear note if the vision ports of the early Panzer IVs were provided with glass protection and everything else. But the later ones clearly had it. And I know from the Spanish Civil War that the Germans were complaining about this issue with the Panzer I, with the original version of the Panzer I, and it's likely that they were fitted out. And Chieftain was in a Panzer I, and he noted they had the vision blocks that protect against splatter. So everything indicates that the early Panzer IVs that were used in 1940 had the vision ports with proper glass and splatter protection there. Now, to sum up ergonomics and visibility, the visibility in the Panzer IV was better, and also it was better to use, so splatter protection, everything else. Additionally, you have a 3-man turret, which means way more room, the commander can focus on commanding, can spot targets, can command, can coordinate with other tanks. Whereas in this Somua, you had a 3-man crew where the commander basically had to do firing, spotting, commanding, and sometimes also loading. So complete overwhelmed. As noted in the previous video, basically a 2-man turret in the Second World War overloaded the crew too much. So 3-man turret was usually the way to go. Now let's look at the next aspect, armor projection. So the Panzer IV had 20mm on the sides, both of the turret and the hull, and 30mm at the front. The S-35 had 42mm at the turret, and in general, because it was a cast turret, and 47mm at the front of the hull and 40mm on the side. So clearly way better. Additionally, it had cast ammo, which is sometimes not as good, but it, since it's usually rounder, you have better sloping, you have more deflection basically going on. So while sloped, if you look at it, the armor was also, because it was sloped, the effective armor was generally better than that of the Panzer IV as well. Generally, S-35 was very well protected. One of the major weak points were the vision slits, because they, as you can see in the shift in the video, they went smaller, so they made it this way. But also the armor quality was rather well and good as well. And Germans generally pointed out in the armor department, the S-35 is way better than our Panzers. So basically the S-35 is the clear winner in the armor protection department. What this meant in practice, basically the Germans were not well protected against French anti-tank guns and also the guns that were usually mounted on the tanks, whereas the S-35 was basically not able to penetrate it by German anti-tank guns and most guns that were fitted on the tanks. So usually they had to be taken out with direct fire artillery or the 18mm flak gun or very close combat with, for instance, the 75mm gun shooting at weak spots or something. Often they aimed for destroying the tracks and making the tank immobile and then concentrate fire on it until it broke down or the crew gave up. Now let's look at mobility next. So speed, the Panzer IV-D had a max speed of about 40 km/h, the S-35 of 45 km/h. The horsepower, the Panzer IV had 265, whereas the S-35 had only 190. Now the ground pressure was, according to Zaloga, basically equal at 0.85 kg/cm². Now in the weight department, they're also rather similar, with 20 tons for the Panzer IV-D and only half a ton less for the Somua. Yet, if you look at the horsepower per ton ratio, we have 13.25 for the Panzer IV-D and 9.74 for the Somua. Although the max speed of the Somua was higher, the S-35 is generally described by the Germans as being way less maneuverable and mobile, although they point out that in firepower and in the armor department it was better. So this was from a report from a colonel of a Panzer regiment. There were various issues with the mobility of the S-35. Maybe they were also related to the problem that the commander was not in charge, and also very different doctrine and tactics. But in overall, it seems that the mobility of the Panzer IV was better. Also, it had way more horsepower per tons, so acceleration and everything was probably better. Maybe the top speed was higher, but as also a Kavalerchik pointed out, usually the max speed was never reached in combat, so it was of less importance on the tactical side anyway. As such, I think the Panzer IV-D is the minor winner in the mobility category. Now it comes to communications. Now the S-35 should have a radio in every tank and basically a transceiver, not even a receiver. The Germans usually had a receiver in every tank, and in some tanks, usually command tanks, they had a transceiver as well, so they could send and receive. So this was planned for the S-35. In reality, only one in five usually had a radio. But again, we're looking at technical definition, and I said, okay, we look at what came out of the factory in an ideal way. Now, Zaloga also points out that in some cases, these were not voice radios, but with Morse code. As you can imagine, this creates quite some problem during combat, and also he noted that the training of the reserves and everything was rather bad. Also, the quality of the radios was limited. The problem is a very limited amount of sources available. Schiften noted about 2 to 3 radios and noted about one that a good line of trees would block your transmission. So in other ways, and generally the Germans have very good radios, which means that likely, even if best equipped, the radios were of limited effectiveness, the French radios. Additionally, also ergonomics come in, you have a 3-man versus a 5-man crew. So the commander was also the gunner, and the radio guy was ideally also the loader. So even with an ideal setup, it was likely not very well in the communications department. So I think the clear winner here is the Panzer IV-D. Now to summarize, in firepower, the minor winner is the Panzer IV-D. In ergonomics and visibility, the Panzer IV is the major winner. In armor protection, the S-35 is the major winner. In mobility, the Panzer IV is the minor winner. And in communications, again, the Panzer IV is the major or maybe minor winner under ideal circumstances. Which also means, in overall, I think the Panzer IV-D was a better tank and the S-35 was a good tank, but definitely not up to scratch in comparison. And if you look at the design and everything, I think it's basically that the S-35 Somua was a late interwar design, a late and good interwar design, whereas the Panzer IV was basically an early modern design. So you have the 3-man turret, you have the radio equipment, the visibility. So it's very more focused on that aspect, on very modern and very well-developed aspects, which of course also because the Germans have way more experience, whereas the S-35 was basically the last stage of the interwar development tanks, and also of course different doctrine and tactics that the French had. So, and also the Panzer IV of course served to the end of the war and was still a rather good tank in late war. I mean, it was of course outclassed by many tanks at this point, but it held through the whole Second World War and stayed in the role of basically a main battle tank. Whereas, for instance, the Panzer III also served till the end of the war, but basically in the end of the war served in a support role. Of course, you could argue that the Panzer IV initially served as a support role, but well, it was upgraded to the main battle tank. This term didn't happen for the Second World War, but later on we had it. Now, since I only covered the technical and tactical aspects here, let's put in some historical context to make everything a bit more understandable, because as many of you know, the French were defeated in about 6 weeks and the S-35 was definitely not that bad in comparison. Now the main issue in 1940 was that the French army was badly coordinated on several levels. So if you read to Karl-Heinz Frieser's Blitzkrieg legend, many chapters start with the trial to start a counteroffensive. And there also was one indication where Char 1B1 attacked, and they attacked, I think, one or two companies because they didn't receive the message that the counterattack was called off. So they were attacking, and actually the Germans couldn't penetrate them. And then they returned at one point when they realized they had no support. So it was like, the Germans was like, okay, what was that? We had no chance, but suddenly they turned around. So this also happened on a lower level. The French were not really able to coordinate their tanks well, due to a lack of communications, lack of radios, and also because the commander was overloaded. And this basically led to the situation that a few amount of French tanks were fighting against the whole panzer regiment of the Germans. And there was one major tank battle, the Battle of Hanut, at this point the largest tank battle ever. And to quote from the commander of the 35th Panzer Regiment of the 4th Panzer Division, "The decisive cause for the German success in the battle against French tanks was the fact that the French always fought against the regiment only with a small number of tanks. Therefore, it was possible to destroy them with the concentrated fire of our relatively few armor-defeating weapons. It could lead to a very difficult situation if the French employed a large number of Somua tanks against us." As also Frieser points out there, the French basically had their the units in a line formation, or mostly deployed in a line, and there was no depth to it. So on the second day, the Germans put a Schwerpunkt, concentrated main effort, at several points, and then could break through. Additionally, what the French lacked in coordination, the Germans had extremely well done. They had very well coordinated tanks, and they also had combined arms warfare. So they employed the anti-tank guns, they employed the artillery. Whereas Friese points out, the French artillery was usually so far behind that they couldn't interfere in the battle. The Germans brought the artillery sometimes forward in the direct fire role to attack enemy tanks. And with the 105mm gun, it's way more threatening to a French tank. At least you couldn't easily detrack it or something. So the coordination was very important here. Of course, it's very important the French had way less experience. For them, tank divisions, they were very new concept that they brought up, the armored divisions. The Germans had the first concept for the in 1935 or something around, and the French, I think, in 1940. Additionally, the Germans used their tank divisions for the annexation of Austria, the Anschluss. Of course, they didn't fire there, but still, they had to move large areas, they had maintenance, they had all the various problems figured out in the organization. Then they also for the annexation of Czechoslovakia, and of course in combat against Poland. And they always revised and adopted the doctrine, tactics, and everything else. So you have a very experienced German force against the French, who were very inexperienced with the whole thing. Now, one very interesting aspect about the limited experience is the aspect that is often pointed out, that the S-35 Somua had a very low operational range, which is actually wrong. But the main issue is, as Jifton points out in his video, that you had two fuel tanks, and if you handle it incorrectly, you only fill up the small fuel tank. As such, the practical operational range, if you fueled the tank wrong, was very low. But in practice, actually, or in theory, on paper, if you did everything right, didn't happen. So to a certain degree, it shows that the French tankmen sometimes didn't even know how to fuel their tanks. I doubt this was the case with the Germans at all. Again, there are many factors to consider. I just looked here at the tactical aspect, because else the video would take probably 3 hours and wouldn't be incomplete as well. Now, a rather extensive thank you here, first to Nick for asking the Oberst question, then to Chifton for helping me out with the question about the vision ports on the Panzer IV, then to Jack for sending me Blitzkrieg Legend from Frieza and Jens Panzertruppen, and finally to Michael for sending me the book on the French tanks and also the British tanks. Thank you very much, and thank you for watching. See you next time.